Hi, I'm Travis. In this video, we're gonna look to answer a question. Were the dinosaur and human tracks found side by side real or fake? Because if they're real, it changes everything we know about the dating between dinosaur and man. Now right away, some of you guys are probably thinking, that is the craziest thing you've ever heard. And let's face it, you might be right. I was always taught that millions of years separated dinosaur and man. Then one day, I came across this book, Dinosaur. Scientific evidence that dinosaur and man walked together. Well, I was intrigued by what it claimed, so I researched it some. I went online and I even asked an astrophysicist who was a born-again Christian if what was claimed could even physically be possible. Eventually, I found myself getting on a plane to see this with my own eyes. I'm skeptical by nature, and now I found myself relying on nature for some answers.
After researching online, I can conclude this. A lot of websites and a lot of opinions.
And here we have Dr. Ross's website. I asked him about the tracks, and he told me in front of 100 people, they found a claw mark in the back of the alleged human footprint. So we'll find out, is there a claw mark in the back of the print? And I will admit, I do tend to lean young Earth at this point in my life. And just by starting this journey and asking the question I did, I almost feel the perception from other people that I'm going against science and I'm challenging the teachings of some professors at some of our most established universities.
Here's what I've been taught about rock layers, also known as a geologic column. The deeper you dig, the older you get. And each layer can be separated by millions of years. Let's take this middle area. Just this era alone has been recorded to last almost 200 million years itself.
And this is my friend Scott. Scott and I have had many conversations about the age of the Earth.
Scott is considered an old Earth creationist. Is that correct, Scott?
Yes, it is.
Is it possible for humans and dinosaurs to coexist at the same time?
No, not unless you want to include alligators and crocodiles as dinosaurs.
How many years separated dinosaurs and man?
About 65 million.
If they did find dinosaurs and human footprints together, what would that do to the theory of it?
The 65 million year dating differential between the two obviously is not valid.
And Scott, you were there, you actually sat right next to me when I questioned Hugh Ross. And what did Hugh Ross say?
When carefully the mud was removed, you could see the rear claw print.
So bottom line, no possible way that this should exist together.
Correct, and I believe even a number of the Young Earth Research Associations have now dropped their claim that that is valid.
So it's now 1:30 in the morning, Texas time. I'm officially in Claiborne, Texas. And the drive over here, I was kind of wondering why Dr. Baugh's findings weren't a bigger national news story. So I went back and I reread part of the book. Dr. Baugh invited a lot of experts from around the world to take a look at his findings. Stephen Jay Gould, he invited newspapers, news outlets, news media. He basically wanted people to come there and take a look at his findings to help verify and to help prove that what he found was actually true. All right, the day has officially arrived. I get to go see this stuff with my own eyes. One of the things I'm looking forward to seeing is called the London Hammer. The London Hammer is a hammer encased by some really old rock. Now, the reason why that's important is because the hammer was obviously made by a human, but the hammer is actually older than the rock that encases it. So I'm looking forward to seeing that, and I'm also kind of curious to see what else Baugh's going to show me today. I did, yeah. Hi, Dr. Baugh. Yeah, my name is Travis.
Yes, hi, Travis. What can I do for you?
I'm actually driving to the museum right now as we speak.
Stupid cell phone.
Wow, I'm actually here.
I will show you the answer to the question you had yesterday. Enjoy the museum until I get there, okay? You were painting buffalo. I said I'd be your slave. Follow wherever you go. That night we spent around a snake and danced beneath the stars. You
then this would totally disrupt the theory of evolution and essentially favor the concept of creation.
How you doing? Wow, hey, live in person. That's so funny. I love it.
I'll get with you.
Okay, sounds great.
Hello, Scott. This is Carl Ball.
Hi, Carl. How are you?
I'm fine. Just fine.
We might have bad reception here, Scott, so I'm going to try to go as fast as I can. So we want to find out what's up with the claw print that Hugh Ross is talking about. So here's the man himself.
I came to Glen Rose in the early 1980s very skeptical of the reports that there were human and dinosaur footprints found in the same layer. Because I had read that there were some prints that had been carved back in the Depression days in the 1930s. In fact, I tracked down some of those and found that there was an individual who had carved, six or eight dinosaur tracks and two or three human tracks. He carved those because originals had been found in the bed of the river, both dinosaur footprints and human footprints among them. Well, I was still quite skeptical until I excavated myself. So what is the real truth? Now, before giving you the answer to that, I want you to know that the Taylor Trail is rather incidental to our work here. We have totally independent research confirming that man and dinosaur lived contemporaneously in the fossil record with or without the Taylor Trail.
In just a moment, we're going to see the print that caused me to fly to Texas. But I want to pause briefly and let you know what I'm thinking and feeling at this very moment, because my life could go in one of two different directions. If there is a claw mark in the back of this print, I'm probably going to lean more towards Hugh Ross and lean old Earth. And if there's not a claw mark in the back of this print, I'm going to keep leaning young Earth and go with Dr. Carl Baugh. Let's find out what he says.
This is a certified replica of the Taylor Trail, minus 3B. Why do we not have one of the original footprints on display? Because those footprints are in the bed of the river. It is now against the state law to remove them.
Was there a claw mark found?
Oh, yes. In fact, an entire series of claw marks and stains.
Hold on. What? This is Dr. Carl Baugh saying that, yes, there is a claw mark. This is a little unexpected.
Entire series of claw marks and stains adjacent to and in the Taylor Trail itself. As more of river scouring occurred, the outline of the dinosaur print appeared, and in a number of instances you have claw stains. That's a lateral, that's a central, and that's a lateral claw depression. Then you can see the hallux heel area here. There's no question a dinosaur did step there. But the answer to the Taylor Trail is that after a dinosaur stepped there, a human being stepped within the Taylor Trail tracks. The ball of the foot, the metatarsal arch, the medial and lateral arches, and the cuboid section. This particular dinosaur did not have a pad under his foot, as the evolutionary community has claimed. There is a place where the human pushed his toes. You can actually see toe depressions up under some of the mud, pulled back, and stepped with a complete imprint. So the claw prints and the claw stains are genuine, but so also are the human. And the conclusion is that man and dinosaur did live contemporaneously.
At this point, my friend Scott actually challenges Dr. Carl Baugh and asks him a good question. Was it possible that a dinosaur stepped in the mud and then it became solidified? Millions of years goes by, it softens again, and a human steps in the exact same spot the dinosaur did, thereby giving the impression that the dinosaur and human were there at the same time, but in fact, they're millions of years apart.
That's a very good question, very good objection. I've heard that quite a few scores of times. Now, first of all, there's no mechanism that has ever been discovered where you can take calcium carbonate limestone, which is very, very hard. It's quite siliceous. That is, that in this area it has quite a bit of sand in it. Some of it's actually sandstone. There is no mechanism in the laboratory, among scientists, among laity, among paleontologists in the field, that has ever been able to dissolve this limestone after it is cured or lithified, and then imprinted again. No mechanism has ever been found to do that. That's number one. Number two, Taylor Trail layer in the bed of the river is actually 8 layers below the surface that we have exposed by the Paluxy River. If this individual came along later, he had to somehow get under 8 layers of limestone in order to secondarily imprint.
Well, maybe it wasn't limestone. You know, soft mud, but something where he could still make it.
Well, I understand precisely what you're saying. That was one of my original objections. So I brought in a world-class scholar. Professor Clark is now deceased. The original excavations, once the discovery was made, actually removed 2 or 3 of the layers above it, but each layer was totally lithified, totally cured.
Are you still able to do excavations now?
We are, but only on private property. So I think you might be interested in what I'm going to show Travis now, and that is some of the original human footprints. Uh-huh. This is the Willett track.
Okay.
It's 11.5 inches in length. There's no question of the great toe, second, third, fourth, little toe, metatarsal arch, medial and lateral arch. There were 6 of these in a series.
This is significant because it's in Cretaceous rock.
It's correct? In Cretaceous rock.
Here's a human footprint in the Cretaceous rock layer. But according to evolution, humans don't exist yet.
CAT scan show this compression is genuine. Scott, it's of interest to note, if you carve a track, there's no compression density under that track. And that's very significant. But a genuine track made in mud has compression density under it. So we can now take some of the carved tracks of the past, analyze them in a laboratory, which we've done. We've never carved any, but we've analyzed these in a laboratory. And we found no compression density whatsoever. But these genuine tracks do have compression density. This is the hammer. I took it to Battelle Laboratory in Columbus, Ohio.
This is the real one?
This is the real one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, by the way, you're being photographed right now. I took this to Battelle Laboratory, the same lab that analyzed the moonstones, same instrument, same technician. We did a scanning electron microprobe elemental analysis, stream of electrons running down into it. Turns out to be 96.6% iron, 0.74% sulfur, and 2.6% chlorine. Now, we cannot compound chlorine with metallic iron. We can compound chlorine with iron particles, but not crystalline iron. But here it is. So that requires a tremendous technology beyond our current capacity. This is the cup in coal. And now, that coal is assigned an age 400 million years. What's the cup doing in it?
One more with this, Scott, sure.
The Meister print at the bottom of the geologic column, this is the real print. Now, you're being photographed currently, 24/7. The wear on the heel, the stitching around the side, the curvature of the sandal print, Elrathia gingii trilobite pressed into the toe area. This is the overlay material. Another Elrathia gingii trilobite impressed in the overlay heel material. This is Cambrian. According to evolutionary theory, this is almost 600 million years old. Got a major problem.
This sandal mark with a trilobite in Cambrian rock is even a bigger discovery than the cup in a coal mine. The reason why? Trilobites were actually extinct before dinosaurs were even on the Earth. So here we have a human sandal mark in the same layer, stepping with a trilobite, before dinosaurs even exist on the Earth. This is considered a huge discovery.
This is the Delk print. This is the icon, the symbol of the museum. The man stepped first. You have the great second, third, fourth, little toe, all the arches, and watch closely. The Acrocanthosaurus dinosaur stepped on and intruded into the human track. So you see some of the consolidated mud is actually pushed up. These are the real artifacts.
Oh, these are the genuines.
Oh, these are genuine. This is not a cast.
So here's the story behind this print. In the year 2000, this guy named Alvis Delk is an amateur archaeologist, and he's walking along the Paluxy River, and he turns over a rock, and he sees this dinosaur print in it, and he collects these things and brings it home. 8 years later, he falls off a ladder, has to go to the hospital, I guess needs money for medical bills, and he decides to sell the print to Dr. Carl Baugh. So he's cleaning the print off before he sells it, and then he notices that there's a human footprint in addition to the dinosaur footprint. So Dr. Carl Baugh then takes it and has it x-rayed to prove its validity.
You could concede that a dinosaur would step in some unknown, mysterious mechanism, might soften the mud, and then a human being would step. But here we have the human being stepping first, and then the dinosaur stepping on it.
So Dr. Baugh, so I know there's the Dinosaur Valley State Park is close by here. Have you had a chance to talk to them about the human footprints that you found?
Oh, many times. I've been here for decades. And unfortunately, the state religion is humanism. And this is a state agency, that is, the state park is a state agency. And they won't even discuss human footprints among the dinosaur footprints. Privately, a number of them have talked to me over the decades, and they've said, you have evidence, but we can't discuss it. And I'm late for an appointment.
Well, thank you so much.
You are welcome.
Anything else you want to say to our audience? I didn't know I was going to be interviewing you today, so.
Number one, critically examine all the evidence. There was a time when I thought atheistic thoughts. There was a time I believed and taught a system of evolution. I do not believe, nor do I teach a system of evolution. If by evolution you mean microevolution, that is variation within genetic boundaries, that's no problem. It is macroevolution introducing new higher order that has never been observed in the field, has never been observed in the laboratory after billions of dollars have been spent in an attempt to do so. You cannot get a higher organism out of genetic information that is always deteriorating. We can alter that genetic information, we can get different expression, but not a higher order of expression.
Off to Dinosaur Valley State Park. I'm gonna go to a government-sponsored state park and see what they have to say.
All right, I literally drove 3 minutes and now I am at Dinosaur World.
All right, now entering Dinosaur Valley State Park. So bottom line, I'm in the wrong place.
That was slightly embarrassing.
I never actually thought I'd be doing this in my lifetime. Flying to Texas to go look at dinosaur footprints. Alright, my first dinosaur track. Ah, there it is. Come on, dude. Leave us alone. At first we thought that it was kinda ill when we thought that you were like a billion. Instead of trying to make a killing. I'm not seeing very much so far. I guess we have to go over here. There might be something, I suppose. Oh, here we go. This looks like it is one. I must say, being down here in the riverbed, does give a sense of a little bit of a time of long ago. There's almost no way of telling what's what when you're down here. Unless it's like beyond obvious and they have something clearly marked. Hey man, them ain't high heel sneakers. See, it's like, are those rock formations or those dinosaur prints? Big hole. But right next to it is a big hole. Is this supposed to be one? I was about ready to leave, and I just found my, I guess, second official dinosaur footprint.
So I decided I'm not leaving this park until I touch one more dinosaur track. I want to go.
Now that's called taking a step back in time.
Wow.
So here's my thoughts so far. I do feel good I got the answer to claw mark question. I still have yet to answer the question of the famous prints in the photo. The Ulvis Delk print is the cornerstone of the museum. And if this print is real, it is concrete proof that the dating methods that we are using are incorrect. Now, that being said, I do have to admit that the story behind it is kind of lame. Basically, the guy didn't even know the human footprint was on there for 8 years until he found it cleaning it off. However, it doesn't mean that the print is not genuine. So what's my conclusion? Do I think dinosaur and man walk together? At this point, I'm gonna say it is very likely they did. I don't give a concrete yes because I'm not an expert in this field. That is why I've scheduled to do an interview with a person who says that these prints are fake and that Dr. Baugh is full of it. And that person would be